ladies and gentlemen, Geshe Michael Roach and Lama Christy McNally.
So, today's a special holiday for us, actually. Once a year, we celebrate this certain specific Buddhist angel called Chakrasamvara. And Chakrasamvara is very interesting because it's like half man, half woman. You know, it's like two beings become one, and they call this being Chakrasamvara. So we thought it was really perfect that this holiday ends up being the combination of our partner talk. It was very auspicious, they say in the Buddhist, which means like karmically worked out totally perfectly. So I thought today it would be really nice to do a little meditation to start off the talk. So everybody get comfortable in your seat. They look kind of like really good straight back seats, but you want to keep your back straight when you're meditating, and your feet planted straight on the floor. Like, yeah, go ahead, move the feet, plant them on the floor. It's really good. Get grounded, and then rest your hands comfortably in your lap, any kind of position you want, and then gently close your eyes and focus on your breath as it exits and then enters your nostrils. You're just focusing on that tiny point at the very opening of your nostrils. So we are trying to build ourselves the perfect spiritual partner. Whether we have a partner or not, eventually we will be with the perfect partner. They will turn into the perfect partner, or if you don't have a perfect partner, you will meet the perfect partner. In order to create our partner, we have to figure out what exactly it is we want. So picture sitting across from you the most beautiful, perfect being you can imagine. Their body is made of light. They no longer have all the problems of flesh and bone and getting old and dying. They are in complete bliss all the time. And they look at you with these beautiful, loving eyes. When you're visualizing a person across from you, first you start with a general outline, and then you go in and you fill in the specifics, kind of like coloring when you're a kid. But the eyes are always very important. Then it's kind of like you infuse them with life. You have to truly believe that this partner is out there in front of you. And so try and get a sense of the warmth from their body. Maybe some sweet smell coming from them. And now think about all the perfect qualities that this partner would have. They'd always listen to you. They'd be very affectionate. You can come up with your own qualities. Then look into their eyes and ask them to come to you for real. Just say, come to me in your mind. And the great thing about visualizations, they always agree. They, of course, are very happy to come to you. And they take your hands and they tell you they are going to take you to heaven. And at this point, it's very nice. If you have a partner already, it's kind of like this perfect partner and your partner kind of fuse into one being, so that you can see that they're both there and they're shining out as this one perfect being. And then just picture that they dissolve into your heart. A tiny little drop inside your heart. Okay, you can open your eyes. You guys are good meditators. I would take you at Diamond Mountain. That's a very huge compliment. So, what would happen if that perfect partner came to you right now, this very minute? Like, would you be ready for them? I mean, shining being of light who has absolutely no faults, who's like waiting to take you to heaven right this second. Susan said he already came. He's sitting right next to her. Well, I don't know about you, but I would feel sort of lacking. You know, if someone like came to me as a perfect partner with a being of light shining and they had all these perfect qualities and I think in addition to thinking about making our perfect partner, we have to think about making ourselves perfect for our partner. Like, we are all going to eventually be in that situation. We are all going to eventually have that moment in our lives when this beautiful being comes to you and says, I'm taking you to heaven right now, you know? And it's going to happen to everybody, because that is what happens at the end of our evolution, of our process of evolution. Right before we get enlightened, there is a being who comes to you and grabs you and says, I'm taking you. So it's going to happen to us all. But are you ready for it to happen right now? And what do you do to get ready if you're not ready? The great thing about working on your spiritual partner, we have 12 different qualities and we're trying to build them slowly. You know, we want them to be affectionate. We want them to listen to us. We want them to be sensual. We want them to be fun. We're going to cover that in a second. The great thing about the karma is that while you're working on making your spiritual partner have all these great qualities, it's also affecting you in the same way. So you're also getting these perfect qualities at the same time. While you're building your perfect partner, you're building yourself as a perfect partner. So just keep that in mind when you're reading this, that this is not just an instruction manual for how to build the perfect partner. It's also an instruction manual for how to be a perfect partner, how to create yourself as the person that he would want me to be. Right? Okay.
Just for people who are new tonight, we just wanted to tell you the general structure of what we're doing. The talk is about emptiness and karma and the marriage of these two ideas. And the greatest writer in Buddhist history on this after Lord Buddha was named Nagarjuna. He lived about 17, 18 centuries ago in India. So we're going to be talking about a new approach to finding a perfect partner. And we're taking it from a very famous book by... We've been going through the books of Nagarjuna. He wrote 6 very famous books about emptiness. And each spiritual partner talk we've been giving, we've been going through a different book. What we do is we take the book, we translate the whole thing, and then we pick out the verses that we think would be nice for the talk, you know? So you're getting a new book by Arya Nagarjuna, which is called The 70 Verses on Emptiness. And then we're trying to relate each verse to a quality that you would like to see in your partner. Okay, so instead of like just one thing to do to find a partner or to make your partner perfect, we've defined 12 different qualities that we personally would like to see in a partner. And then we're going over the karma that you would have to do to create that. Because this approach of partners, spiritual partners, is all based on karma. The idea that they don't exist out there on their own. That what you see in them is coming from you. And then Arya Nagarjuna would say, and that's what makes it real. Okay? He would say it's real because you're seeing it. You see, we would say, oh no, if it's just what I see, that's not what's really there. He would say, no, what you see is what makes it real. If you can create an action, a karma, that plants a seed in your own mind, and then that changes the way your partner appears to you, we say this is reality. This is true reality. To think that the partner would have qualities that are not coming from your mind is false and an illusion. You see, so all the qualities of your partner, everything about your partner now is coming from how you treated other people in the past. If you don't like something about your partner, then you have to fix it. So this approach is interesting because it doesn't involve any interaction necessarily with your partner. You don't go to your partner and say, you know, you have this thing during yoga, you're always like blowing your nose on your pants, you know, and... it kind of bothers me, you know. You don't go to your partner and say that, you see.
I never said it.
She's thinking it. Sometimes it gets on her mat, that's the thing. But anyway, so you don't confront them. You don't say anything. This is the difference in this approach. You don't have to talk to them. There's no tension. You know, you're not trying to talk them into anything. Because what you see is coming from something you're doing. So then you just change what you're doing. And you could change it with regard to them, but that's hard, right? That's hard. So what we do is say, go to a third party. Go to a neutral party. Go to other people you're around, like when you're at work, or you go to the store after work, or deal with those people. Do the opposite karma with them, you know? Be especially mindful not to slurp, or when you have a cold, or, you know, not to cough on people, or not to sneeze on people, or like that. That would be an example, right? But not with your partner, with a third party, okay? And it makes it much less tense, okay? The person in the Walgreens just met you. They don't know you have this problem with your yoga pants. And you're just trying to be more than normally considerate of how they feel about you. And then you take that karma, you walk out of the Walgreens, you say, I was just super considerate to the person in the third aisle in Walgreens. I dedicate that karma to my partner tomorrow, you know, finally realizing this thing bugs me and stopping it. You know what I mean? And then it actually works. You see, we call it a third party perfect. Third party perfect. Okay. And it's so cool because, again, you're not dealing with your partner. You're not trying to convince them. You don't have a showdown. There's no tension. There's no moment of truth. You know, there's no moment when you say that really bugs me. And they say, I know it bugs you and I don't care. You know, it's like that. You never come to this point. You see, it's all with other people. You change the karma with other people. You dedicate it to your partner. So that's where we're at. Okay. Those of you who weren't here last night, we left a couple of pages out last night. There's one that I really liked that I was supposed to do. So I'm going to do one from last night, if you don't mind. You don't have this reading, some of you. That's okay, don't worry. It's called Democratic. Okay? And this means, suppose you have a partner and you wish they were democratic. It's something that we would all like to see in our partner. What does democratic mean? I think in the most basic sense, it means they don't make decisions without asking, right? They don't make unilateral decisions about your life together. You know, they don't show up one morning and say, I changed from yoga, you know, now we're going to do Tai Chi. You know, and you say, well, you didn't ask me, you know. I kind of like the yoga, you know. And then you start to have this tension. So that's not a democratic partner. So it's a partner who involves you in decisions. You know, honey, you'll be so thrilled. We were sitting with dinner with somebody like this recently, and they say, you know that money we inherited recently? Yeah. I just spent it on a 30-foot speedboat, you know. And we were watching this couple, you know, and the lady's like, you know, speedboat? yeah, it's a great deal, you know. And I can't get it until next year because it's all broken up, but we're fixing it, you know. And she's like, broken, fixing, speedboat? You know, and they're trying not to have a fight in front of us in this restaurant, you know, because we're paying, and if we leave, there's a problem. So it's like you would like to have a partner who involves you in all the decisions. I mean, that's the first thing, decision making. So we picked a verse about decisions or about borders. And Arya Nagarjuna, Arya, by the way, in ancient India means someone who understood emptiness perfectly. So when we say Arya Nagarjuna or Arya Deva, it doesn't mean some supremacist thing, you know. It's an ancient, beautiful word that means a wise person, okay? So he would say he was into borders, you know. When you make a decision about a speedboat, you know, there's do we take the speedboat or don't we take the speedboat? And there's a division. There's a line between those two ideas. And we have to live on the line. If you're going to practice this method, this new idea for perfecting your partner, you have to learn to live on a certain line. What's the line? Things exist and things don't exist. Okay? Things exist a partner who's fair and a partner who's not fair. Okay? Then there's a line between them, right? On this side, the partner exists. On this side, the partner doesn't exist. The gardener would say that line doesn't exist. That border doesn't exist. Okay? Very beautiful, very difficult. Okay? The border doesn't exist. Why? Because a partner who involves you in decisions doesn't exist. And a partner who doesn't involve you in decisions doesn't exist either. There is no partner who checks in with you before they buy the speedboat. And there's no partner who didn't check in with you before they bought the speedboat. This is Nagarjuna. So for, 17 centuries, people are saying, this guy's kooky. What's he talking about? He's talking about this. The partner now who's not involving you in decisions doesn't exist out there independent of what you're doing yourself. Okay? That's all it means. Is there a guy who bought a speedboat? Yes. Unfortunately, okay? But does that guy exist independent of you, yourself, not involving them in decisions? No. The partner who comes from you making decisions without asking is there. But a partner who is there, who makes decisions for you without asking you, who didn't come from you doing the same thing, does that partner exist? Nagarjuna says no. I'll say it again. Does a partner exist who bought a speedboat not because you yourself are making similar decisions? Does that partner exist? No. Nagarjuna says no such person. No such person. That's what he means when he says there's no partner that makes the decisions. Doesn't make the decisions. Sorry, makes decisions without asking you. Over here is a partner who doesn't make decisions without asking you. Does this partner exist? Not yet. Okay? All right? So the border between them doesn't exist. You got to get used to it. Okay? Do the things around you exist? Are we sitting up here? No. Okay? Nagarjuna would say no. Get it? No. Okay? Every word that comes out of our mouths is coming from you. Okay? Every word that we say, every new idea we pop out, it's coming because you have had an open mind. You have been sharing new ideas with people. You've been trying to help people. You created us. You made us walk in here. You see, you got to get used to that. Are we sitting up here? Now answer correctly. No. Of course we are. We're sitting here and talking. You'd go home, you'd have refreshments early if we weren't here, okay? Okay, you got to get used to that, okay? And obviously it could lead to some confusion, okay? There's another sense of democratic, I think, and that's where there's no double standard in the relationship, okay? Yeah, like I can check out girls who walk by, but you can't check out guys. Okay, and that's very, very common, right? There's a double standard in the relationship. Like, I can do certain things because in our culture, the guys do that. But you're the lady. You're not supposed to do that, And then there's this cultural double standard, The guy can do certain things. The guy can make financial decisions. The lady doesn't have to be involved in the financial decisions. This is cultural. This is old. This is very old in our culture. So that we'd all like to find a partner who doesn't buy into that. We'd like to find a partner who's really fair. There's no double standard. Whatever standard I have for my own behavior, I also apply to you. And whatever standard I have for you, I apply to myself. And there's no I can do something that you can't do in the relationship. We were thinking of a third kind of democratic. And this is a little bit like more in the sense of equality. I think we'd all like to have a partner who's roughly on our level. Right? Like, we were doing yoga the other day, today, and she does this weird thing. You're sideways, you're propped up on one arm. Lisa Shrimp can do it the other way, but anyway. And then you hold your foot up in the air, and I can't do that, And she's like sitting there, she's like, come, hurry up, I'm up, get up, And I'm like, I can't, I fall down. She's like, get up, And it's frustrating, right? If your partner's not on your level. You have to be roughly on the same level to enjoy the same kind of activities, right? They have to be on your intellectual level. I mean, if you're having these brainstorms and you're like, oh, what do you think about this idea that the person makes the decision that they exist and they also exist? You know, what do you think about that? And they're like, sounds stupid to me, you know? You went to hear somebody say that for an hour and a half, you know? If you're not at all on the same level, then on the same interest level and the same intellectual level and same spiritual level, then it can be, obviously, it's hard. It makes the relationship hard. Now, we're not talking about you sitting there and deciding, yeah, you're right, my partner's not on my level. Or, you're right, they always make decisions without me. Or, you're right, he always has a double standard, like he can do certain things that I can't do, you know? You're not, that's not the goal here. The goal is, how would you get a partner to be like that? How would you get a partner who always involved you in the decisions? How could you get a partner who never throws a double standard at you? How could you get a partner who's physically, emotionally, spiritually on your level? Okay, same level. So you can have fun together, you can interact, right? How do you get this kind of partner? So we made a list of three things. Number one, learn the other side. Okay, and we were thinking more like, don't forget this is third party. This is third party. You don't ask your husband, what did you have in mind with the speedboat? You know, like, I want to see it, your side of it. You know, like, what possible use do we have for a speedboat? You know, like, you don't do that. That's not what we're saying. You go to a third party. You go out of the relationship. At work, or I would say even, like, say with a political issue like Iraq, you know. Like, it's automatic for me, having gone to jail during Vietnam, briefly, for demonstrating, to say, oh, it's bad. You know, it's just stupid, you know? And then I meet Tibetans, like, 20 years later, and they're like, why didn't you send troops to Tibet? You know, why didn't you help us? You know, I met a man, my lama. He said, we saw a plane come over the mountain. We were running through the snow for 3 weeks. My feet were, like, frostbitten. We thought, God, the Americans finally showed up, you know, we waved our arms, and then this plane took this beautiful curve, you know, came down and then started machine gunning us, you know, and it was a Chinese plane, you know, and then we thought you would show up, you know, and then you start thinking, well, what are there people who wish we would have showed up, you know, and is there maybe 6 million people in Tibet who wish we would have showed up? And maybe it's not automatically bad. And then you start trying to think of the other side. You see, personally, I don't support any kind of violence at all due to these rules, these laws. Personally, I think it's just, if you understand karma, it's the wrong approach. It's the opposite approach to what you want. But can I put myself in the head of a person who believes it's the right thing to do? Can I look at the other side? Can I sit down with somebody whose greatest hero is that defense secretary guy, and who I met recently, somebody like that, and can I relate to them? Can I at least listen to their side? And maybe they have some valid points that we can incorporate in a solution together. You see what I mean? So that's the first thing. Instead of automatically shutting people off, even like, people are so blatantly doing something wrong as the violence and the waste of money, $300 billion so far. Is there something they have to say which is useful and that we could incorporate, you see, and that we could work on together? So make it a habit. Even on the worst issue you can imagine, make it a habit. Listen to the other side. Think about the other side. Maybe there's somebody there who was waving and hoping the Americans had showed up, you know? Okay, second one. Read the Bill of Rights. I love the Bill of Rights. I read it again today on the Google, okay? Free exercise of religion. Okay, like we have been in countries recently teaching where I can't wear my robes. And I'm not allowed to speak about certain subjects, you know? And you can't imagine how it feels, you know? And you've grown up with the free exercise of religion. So honor this, you know? Honor this beautiful thing in our country. Our country has all these faults. We're bad people. It's the greatest country in the world. Okay, freedom of speech. You know, we were recently told also that we couldn't go to a certain venue and speak because of our religious views. You know, and this is very, it hurts an American. American is like, what? And they say, you can't come and speak at this venue because of your religious views. You know, and you're like, nobody does that. No, in your country, nobody does that. We do that in ours. You know, this is normal in our country. You know, and so appreciate this freedom, freedom of assembly. You know, we were in a country recently, second largest city in the country, and the government announced no meetings more than 5 people for the next 3 days. They just made an announcement. We had to move the talk just over the city border. You know, we had to drive for 3 hours just across the border to give the talk. You know, why? Because suddenly the government decided no talks for the next 3 days. Oh, no more than 5 people. If you have 5 friends, you want to go to Starbucks together, forget it. You're illegal. Okay, for these 3 days, you know. So appreciate where you are. Appreciate the Bill of Rights. I was looking at the other one. Freedom of privacy and against unreasonable search and seizure. Freedom for privacy of your information, your home, your computer, the emails you send. You see, this is in the Bill of Rights. This one has been lost in this country. We lost this one silently. Quickly, with no objections from the public, we lost it, okay? Think about that. Maybe it'd be good to get it back. It's in the Bill of Rights still, they didn't take it out. The right to trial and appeal. Like, frankly, I've been in like the Tibetan monastery. I've seen people accused of, say, financial misconduct. No trial, no chance for them to express their view. No right for them to have an appeal, no higher authority to go to, and this is just the way it is, you know. And then so appreciate the fairness that you live in, rejoice in it, work to keep it alive on a global level, on a country level, and suddenly you'll find what? Your partner is more fair. Your partner doesn't make decisions without. Your partner is more democratic, okay? So work on a community level, on a global level, on a country level to maintain these rights that we have. And then suddenly, if you're lazy and you let them take away your right to privacy and unreasonable search without due cost, right? Then suddenly you'll find your partner's less democratic because you're not supporting the right of democracy, okay? Last one. Be them. Be them means in situations like work, learn a thing in Tibetan called Dakshin Nyamje. Say Dakshin Nyamje. Dakshin Nyamje means put your head on the other person's shoulders. Oh, sorry, put yourself in their head. Make it a practice, okay? Someone bugs you at work, put yourself in their head. How do they see you? You know, what things are you doing? Put yourself in their body, look through their eyes at yourself. And it's a beautiful practice, okay? The idea of democracy in general, the idea of law and order in general, is this, you see? It's a kind of exchanging ourselves with others. It's like putting yourself in others' head and say, maybe they'd like to vote too. You know, or maybe they'd like to have a say in things too. You see what I mean? It's a whole practice. Democracy itself is a practice of the ancient Buddhist ideal of putting yourself in other people's heads. It's recognizing that they are also people and they have rights and they might have a view. Okay? So honor it. In situations outside of your relationship, at work, put yourself in other people's head. Try to see you the way they see you. You might be disappointed. And you might change a bit. You see what I mean? And then you'll be more fair and more democratic. Then your partner will change. Okay? All right.
We're going to jump around a little bit this talk because we figured out last night that we can't really cover all the ones that we listed, so we wanted to cover the ones that were our favorites first, just in case. So we're going to, I think, page 3 of day 2. It's called Clean Living. It's so much fun coming up with little titles for all of them. Sitting in the Starbucks. So this quality, this particular quality that we want for a partner, is someone who helps us maintain good life habits, good spiritual habits. You want to eat your third bowl of ice cream and then somebody tells you, you know, you have yoga tomorrow. And that's really not going to help that, you know, that Surya Namaskar is going to be pretty snotty. So maybe just two bowls of ice cream. You know, someone who's really looking after you, who would help you with those kind of things. And it's someone who helps you maintain your body, and someone who helps you maintain your mind, a high quality of mind. It's they take care of this precious vehicle, because they say that you know, while we are given this imperfect body that has to get old and die, it is, however, the only body that you can reach enlightenment in. It's the only way to get there. This fallible body is the only one that can transform into the body of light that we were talking about. There are a lot of other kinds of bodies out there. There are a lot of other realms out there. The only other realm that we can see now is the animal realm. But there are spirit realms, and there are all sorts of other bodies, and this is the only one that works to get enlightened. So it's precious. It's fallible, it's gonna die, it causes you pain all the time, it kinda sucks, but it's precious. So you have to take care of it. You have to take care of your body and you have to take care of your mind, because we have such a short amount of time. You know, this life, it goes by so fast, and the time that you can actually sit in meditation without your knees killing you, or without your mind going off in a place you don't want it to, is so limited. You know, it's so limited. You've only got like 20 years or something, you know, it's so short. And it goes by like that because you've got so much else to do, like sleep and eat and wash and all that stuff. So maintaining your body and your mind for as long as possible becomes a really big issue when you're a spiritual practitioner. And it becomes a really big issue if you just want to live a little bit longer. It's when you start to get older, you'll appreciate it more, because you'll start to see your body start to fade on you and you not be able to do the things you used to do. Or your mind starts to fade on you, which is even scarier. And you're not able to concentrate for the length of time that you used to concentrate on something. And you can't do anything about it at that point. So it's very important to look after this precious body and this precious mind. And, you know, who you're with has a lot to do with how you're going to look after yourself. Because we're so influenced by the people around us, and especially the people that we choose to be partners with. You know, you have to be very careful. We got all these questions, right? Thank you for your questions. It's really helpful. Really helpful for us, because then we can kind of gear the talk to what you want to hear and what you want to know. So the more questions, the better. But there's a lot of questions about, well, I decided my partner wasn't the right partner, and what do I do? Do I break up with them? And so, you know, it's very important as you're choosing a partner to look at what you really want. You know, is this partner really the person that's going to maintain your spiritual life? You know, not just, is this the person that's really cute and I'm very sexually attracted to? Not just the person of, oh, this person really fulfills my emotional needs at the time. No, is this person in the long term going to support me spiritually? That's really important to look for in a partner. But so what does that look like? You know, what does a spiritual partnership look like? Ideally, we were thinking of ideally what a spiritual partnership would look like. Normally, when you're in love with somebody else and you walk into a room together, it's like you have this little circle around you and you're in your own little world. And it's like you and the other person and everybody else is excluded. And it's a really nice little world because you're in love and it's great. But it's just the two of you. But in a spiritual partnership, it's like the opposite. Your love branches out to everyone in the room. Your love branches out to everyone in the world. You use that love that you have between the two of you to serve other people, to help other people, and you share it. You share it. You don't exclude yourself in this little world of your own. You open yourself up to everyone, and you say, it's for you that we're here. It's for you that we're even together. You know, that would be kind of an ideal love for two people who are in a real spiritual partnership. And then your time is not your own. As a couple, you belong to everybody else. So you go and you serve everybody else together. And it's the funnest thing that you could possibly do together as a couple, is to dedicate yourself to others. Then physically, everything relates to your inner body. So every kind of blissful touch that you feel from your partner would be used or channeled or directed or dedicated to seeing emptiness directly, so that you could get on this road to the final evolution as a being of light. So every single touch from your partner would be used for your future enlightenment and their future enlightenment. And you would be conscious of that as you were engaged in any kind of physical practice. It would be the reason why you wanted to be in a physical practice with them, because you were serving others with your physical practice. And it's, to tell you the truth, if you're not serving others, it's gonna get boring. You know? I mean, even like sex will get really boring after a while, like 20 years of the same person, oh my God, you know? Well, I don't know actually, but I would imagine. But you can, if you're a spiritual partnership and you're working for other people, it's never going to get old. It's never going to get stale, because you're constantly sending it out to others, so you constantly create the karma for more bliss, for more enjoyment of that sort, right? So you're perpetuating it. And this is how you manage, quite honestly, to stay in a partnership without it getting old. You know, you learn how to perpetuate it by making it so that your partnership serves other people. Because serving other people as a partnership plants seeds in your mind to see your own partnership get better and better and better. All right, in a practical way, what is this... How does your partner maintain good life habits? I mean, that was sort of ideal, you know, like almost fairy tale. We can work towards it. We can all work towards it. But taking care of your body, you know, they'll encourage you to eat right. They'll encourage you to do exercise. They'll encourage you to get enough sleep, right? They'll take care of your body. They'll try and make you do the things that will keep you healthy. The taking care of your mind. They will drag you to a partner talk. They will get you up early for meditation practice. But most importantly, they'll remind you when you're just about to get irritated at somebody that person's coming from your own mind. Right? So they'll remind you about emptiness in your daily life. You know, you want a partner that's next to you that can remind you about these things, because it's really hard to remember by yourself. You know, I'm just about to get irritated because someone cut me off. And then somebody next to me, my dear humongously bodhisattva-ic partner, says, oh, remember, that must have been when you cut somebody off like a week before. You know, and you're like, oh. And it cuts off your reaction. And it stops the cycles. You know, you want somebody that helps you stop your own bad cycles and get you into good habits, good worldview habits. So what do you do if you have a partner and they're not looking like this? If this is not like their CV or, you know, their resume. If you wrote a partner resume and it didn't look like this, how do you get them to change? How do you get them to start supporting you, your living habits? You know, we say everything is like a daily practice. It's called sadhana in Sanskrit. And you want your whole life to be like a daily practice. Because really, it's a practice for the time when that angel that we meditated on in the beginning is going to come to us. So like, every single relationship you have is a practice for the real thing. It's a practice for that angel being of light, right? So it's a sadhana. Our lives are like a sadhana. Our whole life is a daily practice. And we want someone next to us that's going to encourage that daily practice. It does no good to talk to them. It does no good to have a little discussion. I need a little bit more support in my practice. You know, you lounge around watching TV and eating Twinkies, and it's really bad for my practice, and you stay up too late at night, and like, you know, the list of complaints can go on and on, but it doesn't do any good to interact with your partner like this, because what your partner's doing is coming from you. What your partner is doing is coming from your own mind, your own lack of clean living. Your own lack of sadhana in your life. So what you have to do is plant seeds in your mind to see yourself change so that you see your partner get purer and purer in a daily life sense, right? So what can we do? We made three different karmic antidotes for each quality. The first one, send your mom a yoga video. Your parents are really, really high karmic objects. They're very powerful because they gave you this, you know, this thing we were talking about, this precious body and mind. They gave it to you. They made you. So if you're going to do some powerful karma, it's very good to do it with your parents. But you can always influence your parents to have a better lifestyle. There's Jamie with his parents. He's influencing them now. He's dragging them to a partner talk. You know, you know your parents well enough. You know what they're going to be able to hear at what time, and you have to judge it. Okay, you know, but you kind of sneak it in and take care. Make sure they're taking care of their body and their mind, right? Second one, plant herbal teas at work. This one is like making it easy for people around you to choose a healthy alternative. You know, everybody's drinking coffee. It's really bad for them. It gets everybody strung out on caffeine. Everybody starts to shake, and they can't go to sleep at night, and they get ulcers. And, you know, and you just stick the herbal tea there next to the coffee machine. And you don't say anything, but you make it available for them. You know, and it's a third party. It has nothing to do with your partner. How is this ever going to affect your partner? Because it's in your mind. You know? So you, while you're sneaking in the herbal tea, I like mint, next to the coffee machine, you're dedicating in your mind. You're seeing your partner change. You know, because your partner's coming from you. So that little box of tea becomes a very charged object, right? Every single thing in our life is like that. Every single thing in our life, these objects are empty. You know, that's why we could use a box of mint tea and we can change our partner with it. Because the objects around us are empty. They have no nature in and of themselves. And that's why the box of mint tea can be very powerful for you. It's all about what's going on in your mind. It's all about what you're thinking of when you sneak that tea in next to the coffee machine. How strong is your intention? The stronger your intention, the faster your partner will change. The more conscious of your action, the faster your partner will change. Right? That's how it works. It's all up here. It's all how strongly you plant it. You plant that seed, box of mint tea, you know. Okay. Third one. No, he's very supportive of my practice. I don't have to work on him about this at all, you know. Some of them I have like, you know, like yesterday I was like, oh, I have a mixed karma with this one. This one, I'm great. I'm so happy. So, you know, I did something right in my past. Third one, ask for a virgin. What does that mean? Geshe was like, you have to cover this one because you have to explain number three because they can't go home without knowing what it says. The third one is being a good influence yourself. So, like, you can talk to your parents about yoga. You can, like, stick herbal teas next to the coffee machine at work. But, you know, actions speak much louder than words. So the best way that you can affect the people around you to have a better daily practice, a better sadhana in their daily life, is to be a good example yourself. So say you're out to dinner with your friends, and it has nothing to do with your partner, right? This is third party perfect. You're out to dinner with a group of friends. You order a virgin daiquiri, right? That's what it means. Or an orange juice if you don't like it, but I like the slushy, icy thing, so, you know. Chicky knows. She orders them for me sometimes. You get the same effect because it comes in a pretty glass and it looks like you're drinking, but it's like, oh no, no alcohol, it's a virgin. It's so good for the people around you. And you don't say anything, you just do it in front of them, right? Then you say, oh, it's getting late. I have to get to bed early because I got to get up for that meditation practice tomorrow. You know, and you leave on time. You know, you leave the restaurant because you have a sadhana to do. You have a daily sadhana, and you want to be a good example. And then while you're leaving, and you're paying the bill, of course, you demand that you pay the bill, and you leave a huge tip, and you say, well, I'm a little low on money these days, so can I please pay? Right? And they look at you kind of strangely. And they don't quite get it. And maybe they ask you about it and maybe you don't. They don't ask you about it, but some kind of seed is planted in their mind. Right? Because the actions speak a lot louder than words. So, and then you dedicate the whole dinner to fixing your partner, right? You send it. You send that karma to you and your partner's future. And like I said in the beginning, it's not just your partner that you're fixing, right? Because as you fix your partner, you're also fixing yourself. It's like, it's really like you're almost becoming one, right? Because you're doing a karma that's going to affect both of you in the future.
Okay. I just have one footnote to that. I've seen His Holiness the Dalai Lama speak many times, and sometimes I just zone out in the emotion of it, and I forget what he said. And people ask me afterwards, well, what did he teach? And I'm like, I'm not quite sure. But we had a very beautiful opportunity. We had a fundraiser at Lincoln Center. It was sold out. I don't know, a couple thousand people there. And it was a musical performance by many performers. And then His Holiness came up to introduce it. And he stood there, and he got up to the podium, and his eyes were like this, you know. And then he goes, and just this big yawn, you know. And he says, well, they asked me to open the concert, and I hope you have a nice concert, and I'm so tired, I'm just going to home to bed. And he said, could I get up at 3 o'clock every morning to do meditation? And it was 10 o'clock. And he said, I'm usually in bed by now. And he just left. And that was it. And everyone's like, you know, and, but that's the one I remember. You see, that's the only one I really remember so well. So it's like when you give an example of your own sadhana, and he didn't get up and lecture you about getting up in the morning. He just yawned. And that was much more powerful, right? So it's a very good to do it as an example. So we'll take a break. If you weren't here last night, we're asking you to buy a cookie, pay $20. $19.95 will go to sending some of our younger students to a monastery, a Tibetan monastery, every year we send them. We try to pay their airfare for them, okay? And it was very nice this year. A nice group went and they had a really good time. So, and they learn a lot and they come back and they teach us. So please help with that. And then we'll start again in 15 minutes Diamond Mountain time. And do you have to see anybody? I need to see Zori and Lama Ora, Lama Tisama, Peter La, Jamie La, and Bengalmi. Yeah. Okay. We're on page 2. And it's R-E-S-P-E-C-T. And I was going to sing it, but I can't. come to Kirtan at Diamond Mountain. No, it's too late. You'd probably leave. I'll read the verse. Staying, starting or stopping, existing or not existing, and lower, equal or higher. All these were said by the Buddha to exist by the world's conventions, but never in and of themselves. So I don't know, I was thinking about respect. And this is where, remember the context, right? We're trying to get our partner to respect us more, right? And normally, like everything else in a partnership, they respect you at the beginning. And then things fall apart. And this is very frustrating for me. Just as a normal American kid growing up in the United States, right? Like, I had my first girlfriend in sixth grade, and she writes me a note at the beginning of the semester and says, I want to go study with you, right? And then, you know, like, her friend hands me the note. Then I'm supposed to give the note back to her friend, and she gives it to her, right? And then, you know, it kind of goes like that. And then I get this note towards the end of the semester, I don't want to be studying with you anymore. You know? And this kind of just repeated itself over the next 10 years. And then finally I said, this is not... And my parents had a bad divorce. And then I was like, this just doesn't work. You know? So I just gave it up. I just said, I'm going to give it up. You know? It's 20 years. Just forget it. It doesn't work. You know? And then... there's something, though, you have to understand. When you meet a person and you bond, it's because you knew each other in a past life, okay? Always, okay? So you meet a person, you become a partner, it's because of a connection you had in your past life. And it was a good connection, right? And you both died in that lifetime, but you carried that connection in your heart. Then you meet them again and the connection is revived. But Buddhism says an important thing. The birth of a thing destroys it. The birth of a thing destroys the thing. The birth of an orange tree destroys the tree. An orange tree will die. Why? Because it started. Okay? And the same for relationships. Okay? The beginning of a relationship, the first meeting in Starbucks, somebody told me, what Starbucks are you going to? It's so cool. meeting the person causes you to split up, according to Buddhism. You see? It's very sad, right? What it means is the karma that you did, which was good karma, is wearing out every moment you're together. You see? It's like a credit card. Karma is like a credit card. You come into the relationship with a full, it's a debit card. You come into the relationship with a full debit card. Every moment you are with them requires an immense amount of karma. So every moment you are with them, you are losing karma. And the same with your body. That's why people age. So, you know, when I figured this out, 30 years later, right? I said, then theoretically it's possible to have a relationship that lasts. You see, in theory, if I can keep recharging the debit card, this relationship can keep going. You see what I mean? In theory, this is possible. So it's important to understand that things like respect of your partner, it's not natural that it gets less as you're together longer. It doesn't have to be that way. I thought it was that way, and that's why I did the monk thing for 20 years without a partner, right? I thought it's impossible. But then as you learn more, it's possible to keep charging your debit card, and the person will respect you more and more. And so the relationship gets better and better. So the question, how do you do it, right? How do you keep charging up more credit on your debit card, right? And what we're selling you this weekend is third-party debit card, how do you call it? In recharge. Third-party debit card recharge, okay? I'm sure that'll become a catchword in Buddhism shortly. So you have to work with parties outside of the relationship, people maybe your partner doesn't even know. You don't confront your partner. You don't say you don't respect me anymore. You used to respect me, now you just diss me all the time. You don't do that, okay? You go out of the relationship, you go to other people in your life, and you purposely do the three things here, okay? Number one, show respect for the law, okay? This is like out of fashion right now, you know? Like, it's not fashionable for anyone to get up and say, much less me, get up and say, you should follow the rules, you know? You should, when it says stop, when there's a stop sign, you stop. You don't do an LA stop, you stop. You know? And like that. No, we were in L.A. and she was doing the L.A. stop. And I was like, yeah. Because she's from L.A. But anyway, we're not in a culture where it's considered desirable to follow laws which have been created to help everybody. You said, we don't have that mentality anymore. You just don't have it. You don't stop at a stop sign. Nobody's coming. Nobody's to the left. Nobody's to the right. You know, you don't stop because it's the law. You just stop if you think you're going to get caught. You see what I mean? But a law has been made by all of us to protect all of us, to help all of us. And there's this kind of thing where people don't really appreciate that laws are made to help us live with each other so we don't hurt each other. You see what I mean? And so you should get in the habit of stopping at a stop sign. Full stop, look each way, nobody's coming, it's 3 o'clock, it's on, you know, out on Ina Road at 3 a.m. You stop. And you respect the code which has been agreed on by millions of people together so that we don't hurt each other. You see what I mean? And you just respect the theory. You just respect the ideal of a law that helps everyone. I used to be in a large corporation, and we often give business talks. I was asked to give a business talk in New York to the New York Diamond Dealers Association. And they said, could you just submit your topic? I said, yeah, I'm going to talk about not cheating on your taxes. Why you should respect laws about your taxes. Why? Well, for the first thing, you'll make more money. Karmically, you will make more money, you know. So I submitted this paper and I got this phone call. They said, we canceled your talk. And they did, and I never gave this talk. I still want to give this talk. But it's a law, you see. What many people in business don't understand, they don't get it. You pay your taxes, they build a road, then you drive your car on the road. And everyone pays what they can pay equally. And they pay it happily. And they say, if you want more, just let me know. You know, if you need to build an extra road, let me know. I'll pay extra taxes. I would love to. You see, because it helps everybody. I love to serve people, you see. And we have this opposite strange mentality. We don't respect the law. We say, I'm not getting anything out of it. I'll try to get out of the tax, you see. I'll try. I don't immediately benefit, so I will cheat, you see, because I can get away. This is like foolish. Karmically, it's just foolish. You don't respect 200 million other people, and then your partner doesn't respect you? Surprise. You see what I mean? It's karma. Everything is run by karma. Everything. When you don't respect the community you live in, by honoring a code that you have all agreed upon, don't expect your partner to respect you. They won't. Okay? Get it? Third party karma. Respect the laws that we make to benefit all of us. And then suddenly your partner will start to respect you. Does that mean I should respect a law which is foolish or dangerous or harmful? No, you should stand up in public, go to jail if you have to, and fight it. Legally, properly, openly, honestly. Fight it. Right? Don't sneak around it. Okay? I'm not saying obey every commandment you get from the government. No. If you disagree, if you find something immoral like war, then stand up and fight it honestly, openly, take the punishment they give you if it's necessary, and do it that way. So it's not that you, in that way also you're honoring, you're showing respect, okay? Secondly, make a list. There are people say at work that you don't respect, okay? You are dissing somebody in your life. We diss people, you know, and often it's not on purpose. Like we come late for talks, and it disrespects everybody in the audience, you know. And then you just gets in a habit. It's not that we think we're big shots or we think you don't matter or something like that. We're just busy. We have other things. We get here late. Then you have disrespected all the people in the audience. So what Buddhism says is, when you find yourself disrespecting someone, make a list in your mind of why you should respect them, okay? And I think what you will find, if you're already a Buddhist or you're, it doesn't matter, Hindu, whatever, Christian, if you're already meditating big time, and yoga helps it, by the way. So if you have this powerful gasoline and match combination, say physical practice that supports healthy thinking, and you're also meditating a lot, something weird will happen in your life. At some point, you will start to see the people around you as a teacher, automatically. If nobody told you, look, you have to see this person as a teacher. It's not like that. Like, you'll be in a class, you'll be teaching some raw food guy, and then suddenly you'll understand that they're trying to get you to eat healthy for the last 2 or 3 years, and you know, this person's your teacher, you see? And then respect comes automatically, you see? So if you find your partner dissing you, right? If you find that you have lost the respect of your partner, try this trick. Choose the people in your life, look around in your life, count how many people are teaching you by their example, which is the ultimate way to teach, right? I saw His Holiness in Tucson the first time He came. And a mother got up and she said, how can we teach our children these beautiful ideas? And He goes like, and it was like the yawn thing. And then He says, you don't, you can't. And she said, excuse me? And she said, you can't teach children. No, they won't listen. You can't teach them like that. And then he goes, you know what? Just be a good example. You know, just do it yourself. You know, and I think you'll find people are showing you examples all day, and it goes over your head. You know, so try to make a list in your mind of all the people who are teaching you by example. You see, I learned cheerfulness from Ted Lemon, and I learned this generous giving from Ernie Johns. You know what I mean? And I think if you are careful, you will find that every single person around you, by their example, is teaching you something. You know, and then respect will come automatically. Appreciate the examples, respect the examples that are coming to you in the world, and then suddenly your partner will start to respect you and see you as special. Okay? So again, it's no confrontation with your partner. You don't go to them and say, you used to love me, you used to respect me, now you diss me all the time. You don't go whining to your partner. This is anti-whine to your partner teaching, right? You go out of the relationship, you start to respect how many people are your teachers. And then you'll find your partner respects you. Okay, last one. Expose yourself. We made this very sexy, okay? You have to explain it to anyone who reads it, okay?
Starbucks.
What this means is like we do 2 long retreats every year, 2 months each. And each time we choose a different place to go. And last summer, for example, we decided we will expose ourselves to a country and a place that we don't know at all. And it will be very uncomfortable. And trust me, it was. And we just chose a mountain in China that was famous for Buddhists like 1,000 years ago. We just flew there. No one can speak English. We're staying in this peasant's house. There's bed bugs everywhere. There's nothing to eat. Like you get just watermelons for a month and then corn for a month because that's what's growing. You know what I mean? And it was so hard. But as a person who wants respect, throw yourself into these weird cultural situations where you're between a rock and a hard place. You know, you have a choice to go to a macaroni grill or this Mexican restaurant where nobody speaks English. Go to the Mexican restaurant and struggle. Throw yourself in the cultural hotspots. You know, throw yourself into this Chinese community where the word for American in that part of China means spy. You see? And just dump yourself there for 2 months. And feel, force yourself to respect other cultures. You see, throw yourself into uncomfortable cultural situations purposely. Throw yourself into the weirdest places in the world where Americans are disliked to show them what an American is like. You see what I mean? And that's what we did. It's very hard, but then you learn to respect other cultures and other people. And then suddenly what? Your partner's showing you more respect. Your partner's willing to put up with your weirdness, right? And even respect you for it, okay? All right? It works, okay? Third party change in your partner, right? Okay.
I think we'll do one more of these, and then we'll go on to the questions that you guys wrote, okay? So, I have a choice for you. Would you, since we only have one more left, would you rather have like someone who's very supportive and like a shoulder to cry on and yes, or would you rather have a partner who's really fun? Should I take a vote or like should I just go with the fun? Everybody just, yeah, okay, fun, fun. All right. I had that feeling. Okay, so you're in a relationship for some time with the same person, and you, maybe you live in Tucson, maybe you live somewhere else, but you know all the places that you go to dinner. You go to the same place every weekend. You do the same dinner and a movie thing that you did when you just met, and it's getting a little bit boring. And what to do to, you know, or like, you know, you got into this rut with them where, okay, you pick up the kids at 7, no, okay, we'll have dinner, blah, 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 blah. And it's like your whole life is scheduled, and there's some partners are giggling to each other in truthfulness about this. There's no place for any fun. There's no place for any spontaneity, and you feel like your relationship has lost all its fun. So, you know, how do you get... Why did you lose the fun in the first place, and how do you get it back? That's our big question, right? So, you know, we were thinking about this, and we were thinking, you know, what is fun? We saw this really funny thing in the airport when we were traveling. It's, I don't know what it's an advertisement for, but it was a brilliant advertisement. They have this big sign that says work, and then it says play on the other side. And underneath work is like computer. And underneath play is like a baby, right? Then you turn the corner, they've got the same work and play, but the pictures are reversed. Underneath work is the baby. Underneath play is the computer. And you're like, yeah, that's so true, right? You know, like Geshe Michael and me, we're like, yeah, what's fun? I'm like, this is what we did in LA. It was really fun for me. We rented a car. The guy said, for $25 more, you could have the convertible. I said, okay. Like, it's LA, right? So, his poor head in a convertible, you know, he's like ducking the wind. He's trying to type on his computer. I'm having a blast because, you know, I just got this new iPod that someone helped get me for my birthday. So I'm plugging it into the convertible VW that we're driving around. It's like this lemon yellow color. It's such a girl car. And he's dying of embarrassment while he's trying not to get windblown, while he's trying to type on the computer. So like, who's having fun and who's not? The ocean is right there. I'm having a blast anyway. So, you know, you can go to Disneyland and have a miserable time. You can go to the hospital and have a really good time. It's not, it really just depends, because the fun is not out there. It's not in the dinner. It's not in the restaurant you go to. It's not in the person that you're with. The fun happens in here. You know, so really it's how do we open up our own fun, like our own little fun box inside of our heart. It's like fun is a kind of joyfulness. It's a kind of childlike joy, and it's an openness of your heart. And sometimes when we get into ruts, the heart starts to close. And how we create fun in our partnerships is really working on how to open up this. In yoga, they would say it's like the heart chakra, right? There's a knot there. It's getting constricted. It's true. Everything that happens to you mentally has a corresponding physical aspect in your body. Yoga would say this. Buddhism would also say this. Right? So if you're not having fun, there's some kind of physical knot going on in your heart. So how do we fix it? We don't complain to our partners, we don't have any fun anymore, honey. We're like, what do we do, you know? That's not how we put the fun back in our life. We have to plant the seeds for it. We have to plant the seeds in our own mind to see fun, right? So the first thing we have down here, learn how to play again, right? That's a karmic fix. You don't do it with your partner. You just go somewhere else. You learn how to play. You try to purposely look at the world from a new perspective. You're going home from work. You drive home a different way. do something spontaneous. Like, drive home a different way from work, you know? You see a street. It goes off into the distance. Maybe there's a hill. Maybe there's a nice view up there. Just turn. Turn down the dang street. You know, go up it. Look at the beautiful view of downtown Tucson. It's spontaneous. It's exciting. It's new. It's fun. Do something you've never done before. We borrowed this car. I had never driven stick shift before. I learned how the guy who lent us the car is in the audience. We didn't tell him that before we borrowed the car. I was very careful. He, you know, no whiplash or anything. But I learned how to do something new. And how many of us do that after we reach the age of 15? You know, we pretty much covered everything after that. We're no longer learning new things. Go out. Learn something new. Drive a stick shift car for the first time in your life in the snow with the four-wheel drive. It's so fun. he's, like, terrified. I'm having a blast. Emptiness of fun. Plant a tree. I've never planted a tree before. I always wanted to plant a tree. That's on my list. Read a book on astrophysics. I don't know. Do something fun. Something different. No, and it, break out of your old pattern, right? The best kind of teachers for this, and Geshe Michael was just talking to us about how everybody in the world could be our teacher. Best kind of teachers about play are children, right? Children and dogs. Dogs know how to play too. So if you don't have a child, you have to borrow one. You know, like, that's actually the best kind, you know, like the kind you can give back. But I know, I love you. You know, so, yeah, I'll borrow her anytime. But they teach you so much, you know, because they've got this new vision of the world. You've learned to look at the world and think you know it already. You know, you've stopped really looking at the world. Because you've written it off like, oh yeah, I know that. Oh yeah, I know that. You know everything. And nothing's new anymore. And nothing's fun anymore. And just relearn how to open your heart and live like a child, right? Take a child as your teacher. Then, you know, your result, your partner starts coming up with new and fun ideas. You know, you've been playing with this child and like dedicating the karma. Oh, please let us have fun. And then suddenly your partner's like, let's blah, blah, blah. You know, it doesn't matter. Something shifted and new ideas come into your life as a couple, right? Or, you know, they just like spontaneously pick you up in the kitchen and twirl you around or something like that. You know, like stuff like that will happen. It's the karma, you know, fun karma. Number two, look at the sky. It's in the Tibetan medicine texts. It's actually an antidote. It's a cure for like some kind of constriction of the heart. You have a constriction of the heart, they write like a prescription. Go look at the sky for like 3 hours a day for the next month, you know? You can do it during the day, you know, drive to some really open place and just lie on your back and watch the clouds. You can do it at night. You can just look at the stars. When we were in retreat, a lot of times when you do heavy meditation, you actually get this constriction of the heart. And so every night in retreat, we lived in a yurt. I don't know if you know what a yurt is. It's a little small, round thing, 21 feet across that... is made of sticks and felt and canvas over the top of it. And it has one window, which is at the top, and it's like a dome, and it's like a skylight that comes down. It looks like a church, all this light, like shafts. It's really beautiful. But we would crawl up in our yurt, and it's kind of like slanted roof, and we would lie on the roof, and we would do our mantras while we looked at the sky and watched the stars at night. And it was so beautiful. It was so relaxing. And... it slowed our minds down, and it taught us how to be in the moment. And I think a real key thing to having fun is being in the moment. You know, slow down. Slow down enough to look at the sky. and you'll learn how to be in the moment. So when fun things are happening around you, you don't miss them. Because your whole life could be really fun. Your whole life could be really joyful. But we're so busy, we miss it all the time. So this is a Tibetan technique that I'd like to pass down to you. Yeah? Number two. Number three. It says sing someone a song. And basically what this is make life fun for other people. You know, if you want fun in your life, you have to make life fun for other people. So, we've been driving around. Someone gave me Pinky. And lately, we've taken to driving around and waving at people with Pinky as we drive around the street. And you know what? It makes their day. I swear to God, they're all grumpy, and then I'm like, hi! And they can't help but laugh. Maybe they're laughing at me. Maybe they're laughing with me. Who cares? You made them laugh. You know, like Pinky is so good at that. And take him to McDonald's, you know? If you're too shy to take Pinky, then just tell someone at McDonald's a joke. You know, like go up to a complete stranger and like make their day. Especially people who don't have such a nice day, like working at McDonald's, it's really hot and there's all this like dead animal flesh around all the time. It's pretty depressing. You know, make their day, you know, smile at them, tell them a joke, and dedicate it. Dedicate it that your life will be more fun in the future. Someone gave this to us. It's the pink emptiness elephant, right? Geshe Michael always used to say that emptiness was like a two-headed purple elephant rampaging through this room at this very moment. I guess they couldn't find a purple one, but they found a pink one. What that means is a partner who is no fun from their own side is like a pink elephant, right? So this is actually an emptiness reminder. And it is like our car protector, and we keep him on the car to remind us of emptiness. But he's also very fun. And if you have a job at work where you actually have some control, try to make the job for the people that work for you fun. You know, come up with new and creative ways to do things for other people. Make their jobs fun. Make their work fun. It doesn't have to be a drudgery. Be creative, you know? You have so much power. You have so much of a gift. You have so much imagination. And that's how you get your partner to be more fun. Yeah? Okay. Now I think we're going to do some questions.
Okay. Buddhism has the four most basic rules of Buddhism. No killing another being, no stealing another person's property, no sexual misconduct, no fooling around with other people's partners, and then no lying. These are the core of all Buddhist vows. And somebody said, could you describe what a person would be like if they were keeping sexual purity perfectly? Because this is a cause to have a good partner. You see, karmically, one of the causes the most important cause to have a good partner is to keep what we call sexual purity. Technically speaking, the most basic form of sexual purity is that if you are in a committed relationship, that you don't fool around with other people's partners, right? And if you're not in a committed relationship, you still don't fool around with other people's partners. You see, the idea is that you respect other people's partnerships very strictly. And you know, you grew up with the Ten Commandments, adultery, thou shalt not commit adultery. But as a person who's studying karma, as a person who's starting to understand karma, it makes a lot more sense now, right? It's not that it's not fun. It is fun. It's not that it's not like... they play it up in the movies, right? It's exciting. It's different. It's an adventure. It's sneaky. It's new. Person A falls in love with person B, who's already married. And then by the end of the movie, they're living happily ever after. And the old nasty partner's out of the picture, right? And this is like an American theme, right? They don't mention the karma part, right? The karma part of splitting up someone else's relationship, you will never have a good relationship. And I've seen it, you know? I mean, people come to us all the time for help, and they say, my partner's not loyal to me. My partner, I'm fooling around. And say, well, did you fool around before? Yeah, but, you know, anyway. It's the most common cause of karmic problems. So most basically, if a person were keeping sexual purity, they want to know, how would I know a person if I met them, that they were being sexually pure? If they're in a relationship, they would be loyal. They would be keeping that relationship strictly. They would be honoring other people's relationships. What's a rule of thumb? Don't say or do anything to another person's partner that you would not do if their partner was standing next to them. That's all. You see what I mean? Don't make any kind of a joke. Don't look at someone in a certain way if you wouldn't do that with their partner standing there next to them. That's just a basic rule. So that's a beginning. But I would like to expand it. How would a person act if their heart were really sexually pure? You know, what would they be like? And this is just from my own experience, living with monks for many, many years, 20 years. My lama was a good example. 20 years of living with him, I never saw the slightest inclination towards any kind of sexual misdeed. Nothing. Perfect behavior. Perfect. You know, so, but what are they like? You know, how does that affect you? If you spend 20, 30 years being completely, perfectly sexually pure, what are you like after that, you see? And this is interesting. They appreciate beauty more than the rest of us. You see, having been abstaining from sex for 20, 30 years, or being very loyal in a relationship for 20, 30 years, they love beauty. When they see a beautiful man or a beautiful woman, they comment it on to their partner. See, this person's really beautiful. And they can say it honestly and openly because they are not... they have no inclination at all to break their relationship. They have no inclination at all to hurt the other person's relationship. They just are in a position, because their hearts are pure, to say, this person is really beautiful. This person has a beautiful body. You know, this person has a beautiful way of acting. And they can share it with their partner, and there's no tension, you see? So that's another thing. If your heart is sexually pure, I think you would be able to approach sexuality with total innocence and a total lack of tension and a lack of... there's a schizophrenia in America. The movies are telling you, it's good to be sexy, you know, you should dress sexy. All the successful actresses are sexy. You know, the movies are pushing it on you. My lama, I remember one day we were watching TV together. He liked to watch the New York Yankees, okay? And there was an ad, and three like 4-year-old girls walk by in a bikini, and there's a 4-year-old boy on the beach, and he goes like this, and he says, "That's disgusting." You know, they're drilling it into people that the sexual object, that the attachment to sex, and then they tell them, "Don't do it." You see? So this is some kind of, I don't know, it came with the Christian. The old British English, I think, this kind of Puritan thing, this impossible contradiction. You should be obsessed with sex, and you should never cheat on your partner. You know what I mean? it's like that. You see, like, you should, all the movies should be rated for sex. All the TV shows should have sexual innuendos in them. You should be trained from childhood to want it, even though it's maybe not so desirable sometimes. But you shouldn't do it. You see what I mean? And then you can't live up to that. You can't do that. And so if a person's heart is not sexually pure, I think there's this kind of tension about sex, or this kind of this schizophrenia about sex. And they get uncomfortable when you talk about sex. Or they feel guilt all the time about sex. And I believe, having been with people like this, if your heart was really pure, if you were sexually pure, you would appreciate sexual energy. You would think it a kind of beauty in the world. You would honor it in other people, and you would be perfectly loyal to your partner, and you'd be joyful, and you'd be happy. And if they talked about sex, you wouldn't get all torn. You see what I mean? You'd just be, yeah, that can be a beautiful energy. That can be an enlightening energy. And in our particular tradition, it's considered one of the highest energies you can work with. So I think if you reach the point of true sexual purity, you could be very open about it. You could be comfortable with it. You could honor it and appreciate it and still control yourself and still be pure to your partner. So I imagine that if you met a person who was sexually pure, they would be joyful about it, they would be happy, they would be open, they would be warm, and they would be very moral and very pure to their partner, like that. Okay? That's, having been around those people for many years, I think that's, I have this vision of them, and it's a very beautiful vision. Okay? All right.
I was listening so much to Geshe, I didn't pay attention to what I was doing next. I said before that a lot of people had questions about breaking up with their partner. Like, you find that you get together with somebody, and then 6 months later you figure out that you have nothing, absolutely nothing in common, or you fight all the time, or something like that, you know? Like, what should you do? According to worldview, every single thing that you see that's coming from your partner is actually coming from you, right? So the idea of running away from a problem is just kind of unheard of in Buddhism, because what happens when you run away from one partner who you don't like what they're doing is you round the next corner, you meet the next person, and they do the exact same thing. You can't escape from the seeds in your own mind. You know, you can't escape from it. If you run this way, you'll find it. If you run this way, you'll find it. If you go to China, you'll find it. If you go to Brazil, you'll find it. It doesn't matter where you go. It doesn't matter who you're with, because you haven't gotten rid of the seeds in your own mind. So, you know, in our tradition, what we say, if you don't like something about your partner, work on it to change it. You know, think about the karma. We just gave you, you know, 12 different qualities about a person that you can develop, that you can change, that you can recreate yourself. And try it, you know, work on it. Don't run away from your problems because you're just going to come headlong with them, up with them, the next corner that you meet, the next person that you meet. So, you know, there's really not a case where, because it's bad, I'm leaving, right? Now, there are certain situations. Well, what if they break up with me, right? Then you have no choice, right? You're like, well, okay. the most important thing to remember, even if you split up with somebody, is that you maintain your vision of them as your holy teacher, as a divine being, and you never ever let that go. No matter what happens, no matter if you're on the other side of the earth from this person, no matter if you have five partners later, you're still remembering that person as someone who brought you on the path to enlightenment. You know, from now on, you're in a spiritual path. So all your partners are your spiritual teachers. And all your partners are bringing you closer and closer to your ultimate evolution. So you, in your mind, even if you separate, you can never disrespect them. You have to honor them. You know, like, thank you for coming to me and being with me for those 6 months. It was a great 6 months, except for that last month. You know, but I still learned a whole lot, you know, and it's like, when you think of them in your mind, you pay them respect. You honor them. So, there is something that you have to know about breaking up with people. When you engage in a spiritual partnership, it's like, it's very similar to taking a teacher in that it's karmically very similar to taking a teacher, because you are acknowledging them as your spiritual teacher and as your spiritual partner in that road to enlightenment. So when you end that prematurely, like you don't reach the goal, but you still break up, you develop a karma in your mind, a habit for stopping things before you get to the ultimate goal, for not finishing things all the way through. And that's a huge hindrance spiritually. That can be a really, really huge hindrance to you spiritually. So you want to try and avoid it as much as possible, you know. But on the other hand, I'm throwing out all of these different scenarios because they're, you know, scenarios are different and mindsets are different. And I said you can't run away from your problems. So if something's bad, you don't change it by leaving your partner. But there could be a scenario where you feel that your partner is telling you to move on. That your partner, as this holy divine being, is giving you a message like, you need to go somewhere else now, you know? I'm sending you somewhere else now, or you should send yourself somewhere else now, you know? And if you really believe in them as that teacher, and you surrender to that message, it's a very good karma, you know? That you're just trusting that they know better than you what your next step on that evolutionary ladder is going to be. And you just surrender. Surrender is one of the holiest things that you can do. You know, you find someone who you know is your spiritual teacher, and then you just let go of your tiny little small ego pride, and you surrender to like this higher source. And amazing things happen. Amazing things happen. So it's not that you should break up with your partner. It's not you shouldn't break up with your partner. It's why, right? You shouldn't do it because you're running away, right? You shouldn't try to plant seeds for ending things prematurely. But you should try to listen to what the higher message is and where you should go in your next evolutionary step. And it's not always with that person. You know, there was another question here about how to visualize and how to view your former relationships. You know, I had a really sweet relationship when I was in high school. You know, we've dated 2 years. We thought it was really serious and all that stuff. And we thought we were going to get married and live happily ever after. And that never happened, obviously, because I went to college and never saw him again. But, I still think of that. Now, you know, you go back and you say, that was one of the first steps on my spiritual evolutionary path in this lifetime. You know, that was one of my first teachers. And you acknowledge that. And then you also acknowledge that you learned what you could learn from that person. And then they pushed you to a new direction because that's all that you could learn from them. And then you move on. You know, you move on to the next teacher. And sometimes that's the way it works for people. sometimes you're lucky enough to learn everything with one partner. And that's the way it works for people. But you have to listen and you have to surrender and not make your own plans, right? If you're really in the spiritual partnership, you don't know what's best for you. You're the one that still needs to evolve. You know, you have to listen. You have to learn how to listen to those higher messages we were talking about yesterday. So that's all I have to say about breakup or not breakup. Just keep seeing them as a holy being and you'll be fine. No matter what you do, don't give me that diamond dealer question. Should I break up? Should I not break up? You know, it's not about that. Just keep the vision of them as a holy being. And then no matter what you do, you'll be fine.
Someone asked a question that they were considering having an abortion. And you know, what's the Buddhist viewpoint on that? First, I'll give it from scripture, okay? The technical Buddhist explanation is, they call miyam mirchakpa. It means, in the Buddhist tradition, at the moment of conception, a being is alive. At the moment that the sperm meets the egg, consciousness enters that cell, and it's already a human being. So in the Buddhist tradition, any form of abortion, not contraception. Contraception, if it prevents the fertilization of the egg, is not abortion in Buddhism, and it's fine. But after the egg and the sperm have met, and the egg has been fertilized, according to Buddhist teachings, this is a living being. This is a human being. And then to abort it is an act of murder. And my Lama used to say, he had learned this word repugnant kind of murder. He said, it's one thing to murder another person who can defend themselves in a fair fight. It's another thing to murder a being who's too small or helpless to stop, to fight back. So he was very adamant about it. And then, so in the Buddhist tradition, we can't do that. I think it's a little, arrogant for men to speak about abortion, since they're not affected in nearly as powerfully as a woman by a birth, which is also life-threatening for the woman. I mean, for a woman, and a man can't really comprehend that, all the issues. So I think it's a little arrogant for a man, especially an ordained person, to get up and lecture, oh, this is the scriptural thing, you know, and you have to obey it. It's not like that. First, I wanted to tell you what the scriptures say. Secondly, I myself was involved in an abortion when I was a college student. So I understand the issues. And I have regretted it since then. The third thing I have to say is that we are often called to minister to women who have had abortions and who pretty much went crazy. I have gone to mental hospitals to speak to women who have had an abortion and then went crazy afterwards. It's not uncommon. I don't know any woman who's had an abortion who didn't have misgivings afterwards. You know what I mean? I have counseled many women about, you know, been asked to counsel women. So it's my own experience. I'm not talking doctrine. I'm not trying to convince you about anything. I'm just saying my own personal experience is that I've never met a woman who had an abortion who didn't regret it later. The last thing I have to say is very positive. We did a 3-year retreat. And we came out, we had been giving teachings in New York before that. And then we went back to New York after the 3-year retreat. We went into a teaching. It was Shambhala Center in New York, I remember. And there was this beautiful, like, Chinese girl. She's like 3 years old, and she was playing. She had this long dress on, and she was like running from one side of the room to the other. And I was just admiring how beautiful she was, how pretty she was, and she was dancing. And then afterwards, her mother came up to me, and she said, "You don't know me from anybody. I came to one of your talks in 1995. You talked about abortion. Then I got pregnant after that, and I was considering having an abortion, and then I remembered what you said, you know, and so I didn't have an abortion, and I have this child, this girl now, and I said, where? And she said, she's there, and it was the girl, you know, and I was like, you mean you had this girl because of the talk that, and she said, yeah, and I want to thank you, because this is the greatest joy of my life, this is the greatest joy I ever had in my life. And it's because of you, you know. And I'm like, wow, you know. And I was so, I mean, if one person like that in your whole life, if you just contribute to that happening with one person, I think then you're, and that one, I think then your life is fulfilled. So that's all. That's just, I'm not quoting scripture to you. I'm not trying to sell you anything. It's totally each person's own decision. But Buddhist scripture says the person is there, they're alive. And it's like David Swenson came to teach us yoga. He said, there's been many days that I didn't want to do my practice. I didn't feel like doing yoga. But I went out and did it anyway. And there's never been a day that I regretted doing it afterwards. And I think it's the same with a child. I've never met a woman I've been teaching maybe 30 years or something. I've never met, no one's ever come to me and said, I regret having this child, you know. So I think very, very carefully. And I know it's like 20 years of trouble. And Christy Law's about to talk about children as a spiritual path. And, right? No? Okay. Anyway, can I answer that question?
Quickly.
To have a child and to care for the child is a high tantric practice. You can make a very high Buddhist practice, you know. If you decide to go that way, it's difficult. It's maybe harder than spiritual partnership, which is hard. It's a hard path. But to go the path of a child and to have a child and to practice seeing this child as a divine being for the next 20, 30, 40 years is a very, very high tantric practice. And a very difficult one. So it is possible. Someone asked that question. Is it possible that that could be a path? It is a path. It's a very high path. It needs training. You need a lot of training. You need a lot of courses at the Three Jewels Free Buddhist Center in Tucson. And you need a foundation. But if you make that foundation and you enter the higher teachings, what we call the secret teachings, then having a child can be a very high practice. And it's not a distraction after that. It's a hard practice. And you can learn to do that. It needs training. Okay?
Some people are already experts without any training. I've met some of them in the audience recently. That comes from your past life, by the way. So we're going to do one more question. Oh my gosh, one more question. So many to choose from. Okay. Pinky's already sleeping. We've got to go soon. Geshe Michael plays with him just as much as I do, okay? I swear. It's our surrogate child. As you know, we've got like 130 at Diamond Mountain and thousands around the world, and then we have Pinky. yeah. Okay, so this is a question about, I have a great partner. They treat me wonderfully. We have a great relationship, but I don't quite see them as this divine being you keep talking about, and how do I get there? And that's a really good question, right? How do you start to see your partner as a holy angel who is taking you to heaven? And I think I'll go about this because it's the third party talk. Let's talk about how we do it using a third party, right? It has to do with what we were talking about before, about listening to divine messages. You have to keep your mind on the divine at all times. Now, you can go about this logically. There are divine beings in this world. They're all around us. They have evolved to their ultimate goal. They have bodies of light that can never die, and they're in total bliss all the time, and they love us immensely because they've opened their heart completely. So their whole body is like pure love, and it's totally blissful to them. And they're listening to us right now. And they're so happy that you're finally thinking about them, right? And they can emanate. They have the power to emanate in our world as different things, any kind of different things, as people, as things, as words on the page, as songs. We talked about it yesterday. If there are divine beings in this world, and if it's true that they love us, wouldn't they be emanating as someone right next to us all the time? I mean, their biggest wish is that you get enlightened as quickly as possible. So they have to be right next to you. They have to be. There's no other option. They would plant themselves. Yes, they'd plant themselves as Geshe Michael because he looks so spiritual and all of that. But they would also plant themselves right next to you all the time as like the closest person in your world so that they could constantly be subtly nudging you to a higher place. So logically, it makes sense that the people who are our partners are in fact divine beings in disguise. And it sounds cute and funny, but it's actually true. If there are divine beings, they would come in disguise and be your husband for 30, 40, 50 years, or your wife, and they would trick you. And they would subtly push you in this right direction all the time. So you could think about that, right? You could think about it logically. How they have to be, even if they might not look like it every day. And then you can go about trying to collect the karma in your mind to be able to actually see them like that. Now, how do we do that? We look for the divine around us all the time. We listen to the songs on the radio and see if there's a special message just for us. We go at random to a third shelf on the right, fourth floor up on, we pick the Barnes & Noble book and we open it to a random page and we go like this and we see, what message did the Holy Ones have for me today? We get very excited when we go to P.F. Chang's and we get a fortune cookie. I love fortune cookies. It's like perfect avenue for divine beings, you know? It's like your fortune. It's so tricky, right? We think they're so normal. We take them sort of for granted, but it's like, fortune cookie? You know, like the very existence of fortune cookies. It's okay. If you start doing this, by the way, everything starts to seem really miraculous to you. Like fortune cookies, weird things like fortune cookies. You're like, wow, they're so miraculous. But that means you're getting the messages. You start to get the messages. You look for them, and they start to appear more and more. And then, slowly, they start to appear in your partner as well. And it won't happen overnight. You know, all of a sudden, you're not going to open the door, hi, honey, and you're like, blazing light, you know. like maybe if you're lucky, but in my experience, it doesn't happen like that. I mean... Well, sometimes it happens, but, no. In my experience, it happens slowly over time, you know? Everything will be quite normal, you'll be having a nice dinner, and all of a sudden the reality will shift, and all of a sudden they'll look like a holy being, and they'll stare at you in this special way, and their eyes will be sort of glowing, and they'll say something to you that is this profound truth. And then they'll go back to being normal. It'll be like, you know, and you'll get a glimpse. And then when that happens, you have to hold on to that glimpse. You know, hold on to that memory, because the rest of the day they'll do nothing like that at all. They'll be totally normal, and you'll be looking for it and looking, and nothing will happen. You'll be like, come on, come on. And like, hold on to the glimpse. Keep planting the karma in the rest of your world. Keep looking for the divine messages. And then slowly but surely, those glimpses will get longer. And they'll start to be divine for you for longer periods of time. And it happens slowly, but it happens surely. Because karma is definite. Because everything is coming from your mind. Right? Okay. So, we've done a really good karma being here past the time we're supposed to be here. But talking about this the last 2 days has planted immense seeds in all of our minds to change our life and to change our life with our partners and to get ourselves on the spiritual path and to get ourselves towards this ultimate goal of evolution. So what we like to do at the end of the talks is we like to dedicate that, send it out to all the people in Tucson and beyond, you know, that they will find their spiritual partners, that they will find their spiritual path, right? Sashi poki chukshing me tok tramri rabling ji nyende Sangye Shingdu Mikte Uwa Gidro Kunamda Idam Guru Radna Mandala Kam Niyatayami Gewadi Geokam Sanam Yeshe Sok Sok Shin Sanam Yeshe Lejungwe Dampa Kanyi Topa Shu. Thank you.
I'd like to ask Rob Haggerty and Curry to stand up. Jim and Allison Day, if they're here. Tim and Beth Mulhausen, right? And Will Duncan and Mercedes Bachleda. Stand. First of all, they arranged everything for these talks and for many other talks, so I'd like to give them a hand. And if you have any interest in, it's hard to keep these things up for 6 months on your own till the next spiritual partner talk. So, you know, they are giving free classes in Tucson, sometimes once a week, sometimes twice a week. Talk to one of them. If you'd like some support or some reinforcement to carry this kind of teaching on in the next few months, okay?
Okay, well, thank you everyone for coming to another Spiritual Partners talk. I thought it was just amazing. First, we would just like to thank Geshe, Michael, and Christy for teaching us. And Pinky. And please come and continue to teach and help us and take us completely actually to the final goal directly. It takes a lot of people to actually put this event together. So I thought really quickly I'd ask those people just to come up here. And at the end, you can just give them a hand. But first, Anne, for really, I went to a retreat for a month, and she just sort of took the ball and made sure all this happened. So thank you, honey. For finding the church, also is Beth and Tim Mulhausen. If they can come up real quick. Registration desk would be Ben Vole and Lauren Mitchell. If you guys could just come up and just show your faces, that'd be really nice. Will Amir for helping us, especially Will Duncan, constantly, every teaching. Please come. Melissa and Shishadri for their help. Venerable Gyalse, the bookstore, constant support, always. Ted and Andrea Lemon. Rebecca Vinicor for the bake sale. Chuck Vidova, if he's here, constantly always helping. Allison and Jim Day, Jan True, Allegra. Please come in. Rob Ruslinger for doing all the beautiful posters. David Stumpf and Susan for taking care of financial things when we need them. Jackie Fisher, Yat Peng Chu, Venerable Chuki for driving the llamas around constantly, and Evan Ashru in the back, which he's going to be doing. Just stand up and give a quick hi. Thank you. Yes, we have a secret thing for him. Like I said, all those people that stood up, who are probably up here, you could speak to them. We'll be doing a Spiritual Partners follow-up at the Three Jewels Wednesday nights at 6 p.m. You can speak to Allison Day about that. So thank you so much for coming. If those of you who left your emails, we'll keep you updated with future things. There will be a Spiritual Partners coming up in New York City. Mercedes Balita, stand up. You can speak to her about it. That'll be coming up in March. March 9th and 10th, starintheeast.org to register. Saint something church. Soon that'll be every church. It'll be every place for you guys, I guess, eventually. And really Mercedes, because she took on the responsibility of doing all these talks originally, and without her, really, we wouldn't be able to do these. So also Mercedes as well. That's it, right? That's all. We're going to... And really, you can see, it's like this for every event that actually gets put on. And if I looked around, there's constantly more people we're helping. So if I missed you, I apologize. So we're going to just leave with a song, and that's sort of about it. So thank you very much. Evan. And you guys can gently move around and go ahead.
Come away with me in the night. Come away with me, and I will.